an unforgettable tribute to Elvis, starring top celebrities from Nashville and Hollywood on The Big Event.
Well, since my baby left me, well, I found a new place to dwell. Well, it's down at the end of Lonely Street, that heartbreak hotel. I'll be just so lonely, baby. Well, I'm so lonely. I'll be just so lonely, you could die. Although it's always crowded, you still can find some room for broken-hearted lovers to cry there in the gloom. So, I'll be just so lonely, baby. I'll be just so lonely. I'll be so lonely, I'll make a die. Now, the bell of tears keep flowing, and the death clerk's dressing black. Well, they've been so long on the street. I'll be so lonely, baby. Well, if your baby leaves you, you've got a tale to tell. Or just take a walk down on the street to heartbreak hotel, where you will be. Well, you'll be so lonely, baby. Well, you'll be lonely. You'll be so lonely, you could die.
Good evening. I'm Jimmy Dean, and this is January the 8th. It's the 43rd anniversary of the birthday of Elvis Presley, and it's the first one without him. We have brought together some people this evening in kind of a remembrance, people who worked with Elvis, knew him. It's a remembrance done basically in the language that dominated Elvis's life, music. We also have some people that remember Elvis the man, and a fine man he was. You know, all kinds of people made up the huge, huge fan club of Elvis Presley. Some of those who were fans are stars in their own right. And the one that I'm about to introduce now is genuinely a giant in my world. Country music, Mr. Merle Haggard.
Thank you, Jimmy.
There you are. You know, now I know this man well enough to know that there is no way that Merle would capitalize on anything. Yet, your album is called My Farewell to Elvis, and why?
Well, Jimmy, I think that everyone, especially in the entertainment field, owe a debt to Elvis Presley.
Right.
And I'm no exception, and that's the reason why.
That's why the album.
That's why.
And you're going to do a couple for us, right?
We'll try.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Merle Haggard.
From the sun years of the 50s and the birth of rock and roll, millions screamed to hear him do his thing. Elvis touched the life of every ear that heard him, and they couldn't help but listen when he sang. But it's a long way from Memphis to that mansion in the sky, but he kept his faith in Jesus all along. It's a long way from Graceland across Jordan to the promised land, but Jesus finally came to lead him home. From the days of loving her tender to his mama's last farewell, some say he knew how long he had to stay. Well, he lived just 2 days longer than the one who gave him the life, and he almost knew the number of the day. But it's a long way from Memphis to that mansion in the sky, but he kept his faith in Jesus all along. It's a long way from Graceland across Jordan to the promised land. Jesus finally came to lead him home. It's a long way from Memphis to that mansion in the sky, but he kept his faith in Jesus all along. It's a long way from Graceland across Jordan to the promised land. He kept his faith in Jesus all along. Love me sweet, never let me go. You have made my life complete, and I love you so. Love me tender, love me true, all my dreams fulfill. For my darling, I love you, and I always will. Love me tender, love me long, take me to your heart, for it's there that I belong and will never part. Love me tender, love me dear, tell me you'll be mine. I'll be yours through all the years till the end of time. Love me tender, love.
Presley starred in some 33 movies over a period of 15 years, and some of the folks that worked with him in Hollywood have put their remembrances on tape for us.
Well, I had the great good fortune to do two films with Elvis, and I must say that he was one of the kindest, most generous, and considerate young men I had ever worked with. I remember vividly one incident that occurred when we were doing a film called Kissin' Cousins, in which I played his captain. It was an army film. And he was constantly referring to me as Mr. Albertson, and I said to him, Elvis, you are the star of this picture, and I think it would be very nice if you would be willing to call me Jack. And he said, no, sir. He said, my folks would be very upset with me if I didn't show respect for someone who's a little older than I am. I said, that's very nice, Elvis. But how about calling me, well, Captain? He said, how about Sir? I said, okay, I'll buy that. Thank you. I not only found him kind, considerate, and generous, as I've said before, but a very dedicated young man, one who worked very hard at what he had to do. And for him, I had the most admiration and respect.
Elvis Presley's career began at Sun Records, and it wasn't one of the major labels, but they had a lot of fine talent there. And the gentleman on my right was one of those. And I can think of nobody who sounds more original to me than the Silver Fox, Charlie Rich, and yet he said that when his first record was released, they accused him of being influenced or sounding like Elvis. Say hello to Charlie, would you folks here? Good to see you again, nice man.
Good to see you, Jeff.
And they did. They said on the first one you had a big hit, and they said, well, he's doing Presley, right?
Looking back on it, the record did sound kind of Elvis-y.
Well, if you're using all the same people in the same studio, it's got to. Charlie Rich.
Shouldn't be allowed to come and take my baby away. Honey, why don't you wait? All we gotta do is make her. Come on, baby, don't break her with me. Saw you walking with a him just the other night. I almost tripped when I saw him squeeze you tight. Honey, why don't you wait? All we gotta do is make her. Come on, baby, don't. Please don't go. Well, I don't know exactly how it's gonna be. Cause of you lacking, I know that he likes me. Honey, why don't you wait? All we gotta do is make it. Come on, baby, don't. Please don't go. Well, I don't know exactly how it's going to be. Because if you like him, and I know that he likes you. Honey, why don't you wake up? All we gotta do is make up. Come on, baby, don't break up with me. Come on.
Remembrance.
I always had fun with him on and off the set. He made me laugh a lot. He made the people around him laugh a lot. He was very entertaining and very funny, had a good sense of humor. And that was a great relief. People who worked with him were very excited and very nervous to be working with Elvis Presley. And he made them feel at ease right away with his humor. He seemed to me, at the time I did a film with him, very uncomfortable around even a group of extras who would listen to a new song. He seemed never to think that he would be good enough to perform, even in front of a room full of people who loved him and wanted to wish him only the best. He still had the feeling that he had to come up to some kind of performance or come up to some expectation of him that he maybe wouldn't make. But he did, without even trying. But he would try very hard. I think he was a genuinely sexy man, very sensual. I think that he loved women very much, and that came across to them. I think that he sang to women, and they knew it. And although men also admired him and liked his music, he really sang to the ladies.
Do you imagine how this young lady must feel tonight? Elvis Presley was a star before she was even born, and yet she admired him so that he's one of the big reasons why she became a singer, and she's one of country music's biggest, and justly so, I might add. And she's going to do one of Elvis's songs tonight in this little remembrance show, and you folks will want to say hello to Tanya Tucker, won't you? Here she is. Go, sweetness.
You can spare a kiss or two as soon as I don't know me, oh baby. Ain't asking what to you. Well, it's just a bug.
It would be impossible for me to imagine a remembrance of Elvis, and especially here in Nashville, without including this group of guys. 14 years they backed Elvis in movies, personal appearances, records. And they're just part of the legend that we know as Elvis Presley. And they got some songs that they recorded with him. Ladies and gentlemen, if you will, the Jordanaires. Here they are.
Show, we're getting ready now. Don't let go, don't let go. Step on my blue suede shoe. Well, you can do anything with me off of my blue suede shoe. Well, you can knock me down, step in my face, under my name all over the place. Do anything that you wanna do.
But honey, lay off of
my blue suede shoe. Step on my blue suede shoe. to my soul, what's wrong with me? I'm itching like a man on a fuzzy tree. My friends say I'm acting wild as a bug. I'm in love. I'm all shook up. Uh-huh. Oh, yeah, yeah. I'm all shook up.
I will spend my whole life through loving you.
Whether summer, spring, time to loving you, loving you.
Makes no difference where I go or what. Sitting home all alone. Well, if you can't come around, well, please call the telephone. Oh, my heart gets blue. I don't want no other love. Maybe it's just you I'm thinking of. You ain't nothing but a hound dog. Well, you ain't never caught a rabbit and you ain't no friend of mine. You ain't nothing but a hound dog, crying all the time. You ain't nothing but a hound dog, crying all the time. Well, you ain't never caught a rabbit and you ain't no friend of mine.
Up in the 50s in school, and we had Percy Faith and Patti Page and I can't remember now, Perez Prado or somebody. And we never really had any music that we really could listen to and dance to and really get with until Elvis. And there was a station in LA when I was about, I don't know, 16 maybe, that used to play Elvis's records every night at midnight. And it was a black station. And it was the only station in LA that was playing his records. And we used to stay up, all the kids that I went to school, stay up until that time and get up at 6 in the morning. You know, we used to stay up just to listen to Elvis's records.
Everybody said, Elvis Presley has a very subtle sense of humor. He did. He had a subtle sense of humor, but there are times when it wasn't that subtle. I remember I was working at the Desert Inn in Vegas, and I was having trouble. I had a portable microphone and having trouble, and it was cutting out. And I said, somebody, get me a microphone. Now, I don't know Elvis Presley's in 400 miles of the place. Get me a mic. And all of a sudden, from off stage, comes what's got to be the highest paid stagehand in the whole wide world, and it was Elvis. And he handed me the mic and said, was this what you were looking for, sir? Nobody wanted any parts of me for the rest of the night. I mean, what do they want with me? They got Elvis Presley. I'd start to sing a song, we want Elvis. That's not funny, lady, I'll tell you that. You try doing a show like that. You know, a wonderful thing about the man is he was happy for another performer's success. Not too many entertainers are like that. I know 1961, I had a song, and he always liked it. He used to come and catch our show and comment on it. And maybe some of you remember. The old song goes something like this. Big John, Big John, Big Bad John. Every morning at the mine, you could see him arrive. He stood 6'6" and weighed 245, kind of broad at the shoulder and narrow at the hip. Everybody knew you didn't give no lip to Big John. Big John, Big John, Big Bad John.
Big John.
Nobody seemed to know where John called home. He just drifted into town and stayed all alone. Didn't say much, kind of quiet and shy, but if you spoke at all, you just said hi to Big John. Somebody said he came from New Orleans, where he got in a fight over a Cajun queen and a crashing blow from a huge right hand sent a Louisiana fellow to the promised land, Big John. Big John, Big John, Big Bad John. Then came the day at the bottom of the mine when a timber cracked and men started crying. Miners were praying and hearts beat fast. Everybody thought that they'd breathe the last, said John. Through the dust and the smoke of this man-made hell walked a giant of a man that the miners knew well. Grabbed a sagging timber, gave out with a groan, and like a giant oak tree just stood there alone, Big John. Big John, Big John. Big Bad John,
Big John.
With all his strength, he gave a mighty shove. Then a miner yelled out, "There's a light up above!" And 20 men scrambled for would-be grave. Now there's only one left down there to save, Big John. With Jackson timbers, they started back down and came and rumble way down on the ground. And the smoke and gas belched out of that mine. Everybody knew it was the end of the line for Big John. Big John, Big John, Big Bad John,
Big John.
Now they never reopened that worthless pit, they just placed a marble stand in front of it. These few words are written on that stand. At the bottom of this mine lies a big, big man, Big John. Big John,
Big John,
Big Bad John,
Big John, Big John,
Big Bad John. Many of us liked Elvis Presley. Some idolized him, such as the case of the gentleman that you're going to say hello to now. Fine young man, Ronnie McDowell, if you will.
I was barely 6 years old when I first heard him sing. And somehow I knew from that moment on that it would be a lifetime thing. And I'd stand in front of a mirror day and night, and I'd listen to every one of his records, and I'd repeat every word and every note till I finally got it right. And I was determined that I'd wait for the day that I could stand and sing in front of an audience, and maybe someone might come up to me and say, "You know, you sound just like Elvis."
There was a man who gave the world his song, and the world stood still to hear him sing. A simple man who took his faith along while all the world proclaimed him king. Now the king is gone, and oh, what a reign, and the crown on his head will remain. From a working man to royalty to everlasting fame, the king is gone. Yeah, the king is gone, but long live his name. There was a man who tasted sweet success, but still gave his hand to help a friend. A loving man who shared his happiness Elvis. Now the king is gone. But there was a man. Now the king is gone. And oh, what a wreck. And the crown on his head. The king is gone. Yeah, the king is gone. But long live his name. Yeah, the king is gone. Oh, the king is gone. But long live his name.
Goodbye, Elvis. You're gonna miss you.
At first, I was very nervous. I mean, Elvis. Elvis! What can you say? I found him fabulous to work with. I remember the very first day I ever walked on a set with Elvis, he made an issue of coming to my dressing room and welcoming me and making me feel comfortable. And when you consider the influence he had, the size, the magnitude of stardom that he had, I was terribly impressed and really enjoyed working with him. He was forced into that isolation by nature of his fame. He was one of the people who reached such a recognizable factor that normalcy was no longer one of the gifts of life. A freak, you know. Everyone recognizes you right away. It's all over. And so he had to be surrounded all the time and be taken from place to place in cars. And everyone always used to kid him and say, well, Elvis and his group. But that group was very, very important to him. He was surrounded by people that he trusted, that were friends of his, and would keep him really from either getting hurt or getting involved in a situation he was unable to get himself out of. Because if he tried to get out of anything by himself, people can be cruel. Not that they wish to be, but they would be so excited about meeting him or something like that. If he were to stop them from taking more of his time because he had to get somewhere, the minute he would try to pull away, people would go from love to hate. How dare you do that to me? So he had to be surrounded and isolated. Otherwise, I don't think he would have had any kind of a normal life.
Pretty songs, she sings pretty songs. You're a pretty person. She's working with me one time at the Landmark.
Right.
In Vegas.
Las Vegas.
Doing a heck of a job. Everything going along fine. One evening, the stage manager comes to her just before she goes on and said, Elvis is in the audience. She had a conniption, a hissy, and I thought we were going to lose the child. I will tell you that right now. You got
this. This was the very first time I'd ever worked a main room in Vegas, you know. And I was on the bill with Jimmy Dean. And if that didn't make me nervous enough, they did tell me that Elvis was sitting out there.
Yeah. Then what did he do?
Oh, well, he invited us to dinner, and he sent his car over for us. And,
oh, he's tall hog at the trough that night. There ain't no doubt about it.
I think he always was.
You're going to do a thing that he did very, very well. Are you not?
I'd love to try.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, Dottie West.
Oh, I wish I was in the land of cotton. Old times there are not forgotten. Look away, look away, look away, Dixieland. Oh, I wish I was in Dixie, away, away, in Dixieland. I'll take my stand to live and die in Dixie. For Dixieland, that's where I was born. Early Lord, one frosty morn, look away, look away, look away, Dixieland.
We're talking really about an institution here. You know, we're not talking about normal adulation, normal recognition. We're talking about a completely different person. And as I had mentioned earlier, I know that created a private life that I personally wouldn't have cared for. You know, I mean, it wasn't all just money and glory. I think there was a lot of anguish along with that. That's my opinion, my observation. But in relation to, say, his life, when he was performing and not performing, I'd say that when he was performing, he was definitely happiest. I mean, well, I can only speak for myself as far as my relationship with him and the times I worked with him, the times I was around him personally. He was a very nice man. He was a very decent guy to me and all of us around him. Yeah, he was a gentleman, is what we should say, really. He was a gentleman.
When Elvis Presley came to Sun Records, they had a star there that did a heck of a job of singing, and he played what they called called a pumping piano. And people who knew Elvis says that one of his great desires was to be able to play piano like this. If you will, the killer. Jerry Lee. Jerry Lee, look.
Thank you.
Is out. It's all over town. Baby, you've been seen. You've been out here running round. I know that I should leave, but then I just can't go, woman, you went again. This old heart of mine, my God, it could never seem what everybody knew, but oh, Jerry Lee. Hey girl, I trusted in you.
Yes, I did. That was the Killers' great sin. But I love you still. Mama, you went again.
He was always on time. I never saw him lose his temper on the set. He always knew his lines. He was always courteous to those of us who worked with him, and I did two pictures with him. I did Girl Happy and Harum Scarum. And I never saw him have a dispute with the director, and I'm sure if there were any differences, they were handled in the privacy of the dressing room. That way no one's embarrassed. So he was a Southern gentleman, and I think it's something that his mother taught him. And I don't think he ever really changed. I think he was that way before he became a superstar. And he remained that way all the time that I knew him. Elvis was very unique in our business. He was a superstar, but yet he was a gentleman. He was courteous, professional, and with all the attention that he received, I never saw him change. And to the day he died, I felt that if either my husband or I needed a friend, we could call on him. And he'd either be there or send whatever was needed. What I'm trying to say is that I feel that he was also loyal. And when you're very important and very big and very busy, it's easy to forget. And I don't think Elvis ever forgot. I have great respect for him. And my memories of him are very pleasant, very warm, and I have a great respect for that young man from Tupelo, Mississippi.
This dude right here has got so much talent it hurts. I ought to hate him, but I love him. Used to sing in a group that worked with me at the DI out in Vegas, and Elvis used to come by, and I think his first love was gospel music. I really do. And Larry... later on turned out, well, I don't need to tell you, Larry's big all over, and justly so. He's a super talent and writes great songs. And he wrote a couple of gospel things, and Elvis did them in some albums, right?
Yes, he did. It helped me in a couple of different albums, so I kind of paid the rent at the house there
I'll
for a while.
You, he put anything in an album. It just did a whole lot of good for whoever wrote it, and I'd like you to do one of the ones that you wrote and that he did. Would you do it, Chief?
Love to.
Along with his brothers, Steve and Rudy. Ladies and gentlemen, my old buddy, Larry Gatlin.
Thank you, Jim.
You betcha.
Thank you.
Lord, help me walk another mile, just one more mile. I'm tired of walking all alone. Lord, help me smile, another smile, just one more smile. I know I just can't make it on my own. I never thought I needed help before. I thought that I could do things all by myself. But now I know I just can't take it anymore. With a humble heart on bended knees, I'm begging you please for help. So come down from your golden throne to me, to lowly me. Touch of your tender hand. darkness and let me see, Lord, let me see just where I fit into your master plan. I never thought I needed help before. I thought that I could get by myself. But now I know I just can't take it anymore. With a humble heart on bended knees, I'm begging you please for help. With a humble heart on bended knees, I'm begging you please for help.